June 6, 1999. We're talking with Mr. Leon Adler, L-E-O-N-A-D-L-E-R. Interviewer Elisabeth Pozitana, E-L-I-S-A-B-E-T-H, P-O-Z-Z-I-T-H-A-N-N-E-R. We're in Brooklyn, in New York, in the United States of America, and the language is going to be English. June 6, 1999, I'm talking with Mr. Leon Adler. My name is Elisabeth Pozitana. We are in Brooklyn, New York, in the United States of America, and the language of this interview is going to be English. Mr. Adler, when and where were you born?
I was born actually in Coney Island in Brooklyn, New York, April 13, 1924.
And what was the exact name that your parents gave you when you were born?
They gave me the name Leo Bernard, named after two uncles. So, but then my wife changed it to Leon after we got married.
Your last name is?
Adler, which means, in German, means eagle. But a lot of Jewish people adopted German names. So that's about the history of it.
Where were your parents from?
Well, my mother came from a little suburb of, what is that name? Yaroslav. It's a pretty big, it's an army city in Poland. And she was in a tiny little, what they call a ghetto. Tiny little town, people had a lot of children, very, very poor, very rural. My father came from a beautiful little town in Romania, Baku, which is in province of Moldavia. And he tells me it's a beautiful town on a river, with a little church, typical beautiful little town. And they, fortunately for me, they both came to America in 1913.
So what was your parents' name?
Well, you mean my mother.
My mother's name was?
My mother is Dora, and her last name was, maiden name was Handworker. She's related to Nathan Handworker. That's a famous relative. He's the hot dog king. He was. He's dead now. But she was his oldest sister. And that's about it.
How old was your mother when she came to this country?
Well, I understand she was only about 17. And being the oldest daughter of family, children, there were 15 children in the family. She was one of the first to come here with Nathan, and they brought their other relatives here. As soon as they made enough money, they brought them over here, probably second class, to avoid steerage. And it's very interesting how some of them were always very grateful that she brought them. She had the courage to pay for their passage and then wherewithal to bring them here. Otherwise, they would have been gone in the Holocaust, too. My father was...
What was his first name?
My father, Joseph, was in the Romanian army, and he was mistreated terribly, probably being the only Jew that they knew that was there. Everything that went wrong, this was just before World War I. And it was an army, the Romanian army was an army that presently you would call a foul-up army. They were very incompetent, never won a battle. They were on the Allied side in World War I. They were with England, America, France. And they lost every single battle, and they blamed every maneuver, everything that went wrong, they blamed it on my father. He got fed up, naturally. And he actually deserted, came to America in 1913 and got into the hot dog business, Coney Island, and that was his history. I'm grateful he had the courage to come here.
Did you know any other of your father's family members? Did anybody else come here?
No, they went, some of the surviving people went to Israel. I spoke to a couple of sentences on the phone to my father's sister in Israel just before she passed away. But they also had quite a story. They somehow got, they went to Italy, and then from Italy they went to Israel. And a few second cousins are still living there in Haifa. And I visited them a few years ago. They're doing quite well. They're not wealthy people. They're working class people. But at least they escaped the Holocaust.
Did you get to know any of your grandparents?
Well, my father's mother in Baku, in Romania, had a huge crockery store. The only way to describe it is like they have pots and dishes and silverware, and similar to Fortunoff's, from what I'm told. It was a huge, sprawling store. People would come from miles around just to admire the soup tureens and the dishes and everything. And she kept the business up all through the war, through the Nazi occupation, by bribing them, by bribing the Nazi officers. It was quite interesting. And at the very end, the Russian troops came and took over Romania, if you remember the history. And they came to her big store and said, we are going to appropriate your store for the state. So she said, I worked for 60 years for this store. This is my store. He said, oh, no, it's the state, the state's store. They own it now. So she started fighting with them, and they shot her. We heard from a landsman that came to America later, told my dad that he was a witness. They shot her on the top of a hill, and she just rolled down the hill, and they left her there for a few days. So it's ironic that she survived the Germans, but the Russians killed her. So it's kind of a sad story.
But did you ever personally know or encounter any of your grandparents?
Just briefly, my mother's father, my grandfather, he was a patrician-looking man with a very handsome man with a big beard, an Orthodox man, very good-looking man. And he had a trademark. He gave everyone a Hershey's kiss. He had so many grandchildren, he hardly knew our names. Remember, he was father of 15 children. But he lived in America for a few years, and then he passed on. Jacob, I remember him as I saw him once or twice.
What was the language that was spoken in your home?
Well, they spoke Yiddish. My folks spoke Yiddish, but my mother was better at the language than my father, and she knew quite a few Germanic words, deep words. She was very bright, but unfortunately she never had an education. But she did try to speak English. I spoke English to her. Once I started going to school, kids were making fun of my Yiddish inflection. So I tried to drop that. I tried to get away from that so they wouldn't make fun of me. But it was interesting. She always wanted to know what was in the books that I brought home, the school books. And she was more the intellectual than my father. He was just a working man. But one interesting I'm leaving out, my grandmother didn't quite make it.
Which
to
grandmother?
My mother's mother,
yeah.
The woman that had all those children.
Right.
She was within sight of the Statue of Liberty. It was on the front page. A cousin of mine had that clipping, and I'm sorry I never kept a copy of that clipping. It said, mother of 15 or 16 dies within sight of the Statue of Liberty. She came on third or steerage. She should have been brought here by second class or first class. So she was a woman in her late 50s, shouldn't have died. She was just worn out from what she had been through before World War One, and unfortunately she passed on just then. And the Times had the article on the front page. It was another sad chapter. So naturally I never met her. My mother was here already, ahead of her. But it's one of those sad things in the twist of fate, you know.
Do you have any brothers or sisters?
Yeah, I have my older brother, Irving, lives in Avenel, New Jersey. And we've been friends all our lives. We call each other on the phone. We're not only brothers, we're friends, you know. And I have a half-sister that she just dropped out because there was a family argument about she wanted to suddenly retain the name of her father. See, her father was a different man. My mother was married twice. So we boys resented that she took this man's name rather than Adler, Mr. Adler, Joseph Adler, actually brought her up. The first father hardly ever saw her. He died when she was just an infant. So why honor him by changing your name? So she left in a huff. We've tried to contact her since. She's still alive.
What is her name?
Ruth. Ruth lives, as far as we know, in Florida somewhere. But we can't. The Social Security says she's still alive. She's getting Social Security. But unless she accedes to it, they will not give her address unless she agrees to it. That's the ruling of the Social Security. And that's several months ago. We tried to really reach her, my brother and I, and it's impossible. She somehow refuses to be in touch with us anymore. She's probably old and ill, you know. She's older than us.
Back to your early childhood. Where did you start going to school? What school was that?
Well, I always went to public schools. There's a school, PS 209, a regular public school. It's over here on Coney Island Avenue, near Coney Island. And it was a very, very good school, as far as I remember. Dedicated teachers, very, very fine. I don't know how it is today. But from there, I went to Abraham Lincoln High School. And I did quite well. I should have continued on. I just took college courses. I never really went to college. And I regretted it because I had to make money. As soon as I got out of high school, I had to try to go to work. And whomever I meet, I say, do not do that. Go on to college as much as you can, no matter what it takes. I've given that advice to young people, and I've always believed that. So.
Did your brother go on to college?
No, he never made college. He, very funny thing about him, he's spent his life, he's interested in gambling. He's a gambler. Not a habitual gambler, but that's what he's interested in. And he never really pursued it. He has a good head, good mathematician, everything. He wasted his He lost his calling. To put it mildly.
When you mentioned your grandfather, you said he was Orthodox. Did your mother keep a kosher home?
As far as I know, I would say yes, she did. My father didn't really care, but she did. She was the backbone of the family. She was the one that would tell you wonderful things that many old Jewish mothers would say to their kids. You know, don't touch what's not yours. Respect people, respect animals. She was always with these words of wisdom. You know, do unto others as you would have done to you. Things like that. And it rubs off. You remember these things.
What kind of importance did your Jewish religion have in your family life?
We just went to shul on the high holidays. My brother and I weren't too religious somehow. I remember thinking as a child it was very funny. We went into shul. We thought it was funny, uproarious. But later on I realized, you know, what it meant. And in the army I made sure that I went to every service I could.
Actually, were you drafted? Or did you sign up?
No, my brother had gone into the Navy. He volunteered for the Navy. My brother was 2 years older. So I wanted to go into the Navy too. So they gave me an agility test, like jump up on that table. And I was a city kid. I wasn't used to these things. So I couldn't do it, or I wasn't able to. I don't know what it was. So they said, oh, you're not agile enough for the Navy. So they rejected me. So I was very disappointed. And I waited a few months, and they finally drafted me.
What year was that?
In 1943. I want to say, by the way, I was born with hammer toes on my right foot. I actually only walk on two toes on my right foot. And can you imagine? They asked me, are you capable of marching and everything? I said, yeah, I was anxious to go in. And they saw my foot was very bad, and yet I was put in the infantry. I walked probably thousands of miles, and it was difficult. I had to get special shoes from the army, and gradually I got used to it. I did well, but I should never have been drafted with a foot like that.
When you first got drafted, where did you go?
Well, that's a story in itself. I'll make it brief. We were shipped out, all us little frightened little guys, were shipped all the way out to Long Island, Patchogue, Long Island, which was Camp Upton. And we were kept in our summer clothing. We had light clothing on. It was April. And I remember wearing just a light shirt, light, very light, no, not even a jacket. Kept us up all night going, getting different shots, injections, and you know how when you're in the army, they push you around. 100 guys go in here and 100 over there. So I developed a bad cold. I was sniffling, and you crowded into a small tent, and spinal meningitis was going around. And I was a good candidate for that. I caught it. See, because when you're in close quarters, people are coughing and sneezing in a small enclosure. So anyway, I was in the hospital for about a month. I had one night where I was told I was very close to dying. Spinal meningitis is a very painful illness, and it's painful in the head. It's an inflammation of the brain's membrane. So what I'm trying to think of is I somehow survived because they, by luck, they came out with sulfanilamide. There were no antibiotics in 1943. The sulfur, by luck, I was able to take it. It worked on me. And that I survived that. Naturally, I was anxious to get out of the hospital. So they said, well, you could stay here another few weeks to recover. I was still very weak. It affected my knee, my back a little bit. So they said, all right, you're anxious to get out. So they shipped me down to Camp Shelby in Mississippi, which is what they call a hellhole. It's actually the surrounding area of Hattiesburg, Mississippi is a jungle. Real, as close to a jungle in America as you can get. And the conditions were hot and humid, and terrible. And I went through basic training and everything. And gradually I got back my strength. And, well, I'm going on with it. From there, we took about a year and a half of real heavy training. We were supposed to be medical men, medical aid men. And you had to really learn materia medica. You had to learn structure of the human body. You know, you really had to know, and above all, how to make a quick first aid. Someone got wounded. See, we were in a medical battalion of 500 men belonging to the 69th Infantry Division. We didn't have weapons. So we took tremendous training over and over, patching up people, making believe, you know, carrying them. And have a broken leg, we'd have to know how to splint that leg and so on, give blood plasma, which we did later on. We were a real crack outfit. We were good.
Who were the others in your battalion?
We had medical men. They were doctors, surgeons. We had technicians. Like some sergeants were trained on giving blood plasma at that time and assisting in operations, which I did occasionally during the war.
Were there any other Jewish soldiers in your battalion,
In my company, yeah, there were several. One happens to live right here in this project. I bumped into him, Archie Maltzman. He was in Company B and I was in Company A. I remember talking to him so many years ago, but he doesn't remember me. I sought him out. I heard that there was a Jewish fellow from Brooklyn, so I ran over to talk to him.
Did that matter at all if you were Jewish or non-Jewish in the group dynamics?
There was a certain camaraderie because we were only five of us out of 110 men. Two other men were Jewish, which I knew, and they chose not to say that they're Jewish. Because at that time, it was even more prejudiced than there is today. And I remember a lot of prejudice. Little words were said behind my back. And being young and having good ears, I could hear their comments. But I rarely argued with them.
Did you feel
sometimes
that?
Sometimes I did.
Was there a difference in the anti-Semitism that you ran into in the army as compared to what you had experienced before in school or in your working life?
Yes, it different? In school it was more personal. Like the kids were very cruel, like when I went to public school. They would say cruel things, you know. You killed Jesus, things like that. But later on, in the army, there were a lot of subtleties. One fellow I remember talking to that really stays in my mind because I was very hurt in Camp Shelby. He was a graduate of Ohio University. He was, I think, a corporal, which is a non-commissioned officer, which is a little up there. I was just a private. So he said some little subtle remarks about the Jews killing Jesus and turning him in, and they're interested in stealing money from the people, you know, all these awful things. And he came out with, like, then he started a diatribe, and I'm just standing there, stunned. And things that I don't think about every day. You loan money to people, and then you, if they don't pay you back, you put a curse on them, and you should have horns, all these stupid things. So at the end of all that, this is the one time I really fought back. I said, you know, what you said to me really hurts. He says, why? I'm just telling you the truth. I said, it hurts because you're an educated man, and you're really basically a likable, decent guy. I said, what are you? He says, I'm a Christian. I said, you know, a true Christian does not say things to hurt people, does not say these lies, unfounded lies. And why do you want to hurt me like that? I'm a fellow soldier and a fellow human being. So he sat there for a half hour. He was stunned, like stupefied. I remember going out of the tent or whatever it is, coming back, he was still sitting there mulling it over. You know, he never bothered me again. He never said this again. Because, he did say one time later on, he says, nobody ever spoke to me that way. I says, well, it's about time they did. So it's one experience that stays in my mind because I was so hurt. If someone, hillbilly, what we call a hillbilly, an idiot, you know, farm boy, a moron, semi-moron, would say that, I would say, oh, he's just ignorant. But a guy like that really...
Did he have the same rank as
no,
you?
No, I was a private. He was a corporal, as I said. Yeah, but he should have known better.
What about holidays, Jewish holidays in the army? Was
everything. Every holiday we went, made sure we went to the chapel. We had a chaplain. He was a wonderful guy.
Do you remember his name?
No, I don't remember, but he was the official chaplain of the division. 69th Division had 15,000 men, approximately. And he was the only Jewish chaplain for all those men, because we were only 4 or 5% of the people. But he made sure that we went. He rousted us out of bed. You go. You go. We're having services today. Adler, let's go. And I got out of bed, and it was my day off, and I went.
And we have to stop this tape.
Like the book.
June 6, 1999. This is tape number 2, talking with Mr. Leon Adler. When did they ship you? did they ship you over to Europe?
We finally went to Europe. We went to England in December. I think it was December of 1944. We stayed there about a month. And from what I recall, the treatment we got from the English people was wonderful. They were very kind, sacrificing. They gave us food that I'm sure was from their own table, so we would have food to eat. And I remember going to a restaurant. I went to Southampton on a one-day pass, and in the restaurant they said to me, for example, order whatever you want. So I ordered some food, and then they came around with a tray with all kinds of desserts. And an American sergeant whom I did not know was sitting in the restaurant. He says, just take one, because these, that's very touching. These people are doing without, and they're watching you. All the eyes of the restaurant is on you. So if you take more than one, it's not nice. So I remember taking a little eclair or something, and it's just typical. They opened up their homes to us, had dances.
Where were you?
We were in what they call Southampton. That's the area around, Southampton's there. Brighton Beach. They have a Brighton Beach there, believe it or not. The southern end of England. Very lovely, lovely, beautiful rivers and trees. Then we went, one night we all packed up, and we went by barge. It was a horrible ride across the English Channel, and we landed in Le Havre. Overnight, 10-hour ride, a terrible, bumpy, horrible ride. The English Channel can be very wild. This was in January. In December in England, then January we were going to France. And I remember a lot of people were sick. I didn't get seasick, because I used to go boating in Cheapside Bay, which is not far from where I live. Anyway. We landed in Le Havre, which was very badly damaged. I remember the sign, Cinzano Wines, was the only thing standing. The whole city was obliterated. And then we got into we had 10 ambulances. We had 110 men in our company, Company A. 10 ambulances and about 10 squads of what they call litter bearers, stretcher bearers. So with the two factions of people that are geared to bring people back to the army, to the hospital, to the field hospital. That was our prime duty, to try to save wounded people, wounded soldiers.
You were a litter bearer?
I was a litter bearer, and it was a very, very taxing, tough job. You have to go over all kinds of terrain. You could carry a 200-pound man or a 140-pound man, depending on who got hurt. And it was very difficult. Sometimes we actually trip and fall and drop the poor guy, you know, and there he was moaning on the floor, and we put him back and carry him again, sometimes as much as 2-3 miles. We were tough guys. We were tough.
When and where or how soon did you get into... kind of battle or
action? That came a little later. I want to make it fast. We went through northern France. We were on our way to the Battle of the Bulge, which was in Belgium. So France comes first. We went through France, and the only incident I remember, we stopped in it's on the map. Forges-les-Eaux is the name of this. It's a casino town, similar to Atlantic City. Had a big, beautiful casino, and we slept in the casino, I remember, on some straw. And from there, we went to, where nuns are. It's not a monastery. What's the It was like houses, like townhouses surrounding a square. So the thing that stuck in my memory, this is still in France, the French nun told me in broken English, I tried to talk to her. I was always interested in what's going on. And she said, La Boche, which she called the Germans, she says they were savage. So I said, you mean they were savages? She says, yes. They threw all their statues out the window into the courtyard to break them for no reason. She begged them, these are ancient relics, some of 400 or 500 years old. Why are you doing it? They wouldn't answer her, and they threw all their religious things out. And I remember feeling so hurt for her. And then she had a school with the children. We had a kitchen truck where we served our meals for the whole company. And we would throw the food out at the end of the day. We had extra potatoes and stuff. So and then we put coffee beans, we used coffee grounds. We dump it on with the potatoes and whatever food was left in these garbage cans. So she one day came to me about 4 days later, the head nun. She says, please don't put the coffee beans in the potatoes. So I said, why? You're bringing it for your cattle, for your cows. She says, no, the children are eating that food. They're no food. So I remember that. She was so timid to ask me. I says, of course I'll keep the inedible food separately. You should have just told me. She was afraid to tell me I would get angry or something. So I remember that incident. Then from there, we went through the Ardennes forest. We saw hundreds and hundreds of flying fortresses flying overhead at that time, bombing Germany. One plane was caught by an anti-aircraft and blew up right in front of our eyes, way high up there. And one of the poor guys, probably a machine tail gunner from the airplane, came straight down and he landed in the earth about up to his knees in the earth. That's how he fell. It was a terrible thing to see. That was in the Hirchen Forest. From there, we hit the Siegfried Line, and the whole division, probably more, 15,000 men, probably parts of other divisions, were held up in the Siegfried Line. They had this huge cannon, built by slave labor, by the way. Cannon came out of this cliff, which is about 100 feet high. Cannon came out, shot at us, and receded into the concrete. It's like 6 foot thick concrete. And we had no way of stopping them. And we were actually held up. The invasion of Germany was stymied.
Over there France, Belgium, moving east,
borderline.
How much were you informed, or could you inform yourself about what was actually happening?
We were very naive. We knew nothing. I had some knowledge that they were killing Jews, but I never realized the extent. But our officers were extremely naive. The American army was very easygoing. They didn't know half of what they should have known. And I to this day, I resent that. So anyway, this gun was stopped, and one of the fellows climbed up that cliff, and he poured gasoline into the aperture of this where the cannon came in and out, came out and shot and came back. And he set it on fire, and you could hear the Germans inside screaming. And that stopped the gun, and we proceeded on. We we broke through the Siegfried line at that point. It was very, very interesting. By the way, the fellow that did this heroic act never got an award for it. We don't know why.
Do you know who it was?
We understand it was an Italian fellow from the Bronx. He actually climbed up there and got no recognition for it. He should have. You know, he did a wonderful thing. I think he should have gotten a Congressional Medal of Honor. And well, anyway, we started going into what they call the Rhineland, which was the mountainous area where the Siegfried Line was. Then we went to the Harz Mountains. Then we went into what's the Rolling Plains, which is a beautiful country, the Rhine River, churches, cities like Cologne and Kassel, which were ruined, so badly ruined. I remember seeing sewer pipes sticking up into the air. That's how thoroughly smashed they were. And later on, you'd see other cities that weren't touched. Heidelberg, for example, where the Heidelberg University was not scratched.
Did you get to interact with any civilians when you came into Germany?
Yeah, the woman mayor, as I told you before, the woman mayor of Gießen. She was a stout woman with a badge of authority around her neck. I don't know, it was keys or a cross or something. But she told us she's the official mayor and she wants to surrender to us. So I said, we're only medics. You surrender to the infantry. So she says, no, you look kind. You're like you're not going to hurt us. And meanwhile, there were Germans hiding behind the buildings. They were very furtive, afraid that we're going to do something. They were probably guilty of different foul deeds that they did. Well, anyway, we told her to bring all the weaponry she has and throw them down at us, and then we're going to take her back with a jeep. We send her back to headquarters. And I believed she was the mayor. She was very important. She spoke good English. I have a relative in Chicago. They all had relatives in Chicago. That was the interaction there.
When moving forward, did you come into people's houses?
We got into their houses. We were always chasing the German army, but occasionally someone would stop to fight, and it was extreme heavy firepower. We went into their houses when, one time I remember, General Patton had broken through with the Third Army. The Third Army was to the south of us. My outfit was part of the First Army. Thousands, hundreds of thousands of people involved. The Third Army was so far ahead, they needed all the supplies they can get. So we went hungry. Our supply trucks didn't arrive for us. They was bringing food and ammunition and gasoline to Patton. So I was speaking to one of our officers, our sergeant, and I told him, there are German farms here. Don't tell me that a German farmer doesn't have food in the basement. Every farmer has food in the basement, something to eat. Why are we going hungry? He said, well, you speak a little German. Go ahead, speak to them. So I went to this, I remember going to this farmer, very jovial, you know, hello, how are you, bowing to me. So I said, where do you have food? So he says, we have food. So I says, bring it up. So he had, I remember, cherries in a jar. He had pickled eggs, you know, preserved. Everything was preserved in a cold basement. So he says, this is not good enough for American army. I says, oh, yes, it is. You keep bringing that up from the basement. You know, we were the conquering army, but we didn't behave as such. We were too nice to them.
Do you recall where that was?
It's some some little area in the, what they call the Rhineland. I don't remember the exact city. And from there, the only interaction that I recall very vividly, we were crossing the Fulda River, which was a narrow river. It's on the map. It's a town called Wiesenfels, White Fields, a pretty big town, and the river runs right next to it. So we were stopped by this fast-moving river, which was more like a canal with cement on each side of the canal. And suddenly, I was right in the front with all the medics and the infantry. We were trying to cross with little rubber rafts. We started a half mile up because the river was flowing so fast. So we'd land right a certain spot. We timed it. All of a sudden, machine gun fire opened up. And about 20 of our boys that just got off these little rubber rafts were wounded, some of them pretty bad. And they were lying on the bank of the furthest bank of the river on the concrete. So our job was to try to pull them off and bring them back. But we found out later it was a woman shooting a machine gun at us. And she didn't kill miraculously, nobody died. But she injured about 20 men. And we knew our stuff. We rolled our raincoat out, and by turning his feet over, we grabbed him and pulled him down. And meanwhile, bullets are flying over our head. Pulling him was a terrible day. It was my birthday, April 13, 1945. And we pulled different guys off, put them on the boat, and rescued them. We gave them first aid, sent them back. And then we finally, the machine gun stopped. One of the infantry the machine gun out of action. She was firing from an apartment house, a big, beautiful apartment house from opposite. So we went in and the interaction was, we said to the German tenants, mostly women, children, who was shooting at us? So everyone, to a person, they all said, pointed at this woman. She was the block leader. In other words, she was the one who informed on the others. And very despicable woman, very stern, very staunch, you know, real Nazi. Well, one of our officers just went into our apartment and just ripped our apartment apart and had her arrested, because the war was almost over and we felt that she was not a soldier. We arrested her as a spy, but she did some damage that day. I'll never forget Wiesenfels. That was a very bad day. But we're proud to say we saved a lot of men, including one man, a black man, was a replacement, a last-minute replacement. The war was going to be over in a few weeks. He actually carried these people through that raging river over his head. Big, powerful man, at least 6 feet tall. Over his head, he carried those wounded people. And even the Southerners that said, you know, they hate blacks, you know, they call them niggers. I'm never going to talk against a nigger again. One of them said to me, he said, what that guy did was a powerful man to carry a 200-pound man over his head across that river. It's unforgettable. But I'm proud to say we saved everybody. No one died that day. As a group, we did a wonderful job.
Do you recall where it was that you started to understand that the Allies were actually winning the war?
Oh, no, we knew right away. As soon as it was a matter of time, we crossed the Rhine River, which was their last big defense. We knew they were really a ragtag army by then. They were pockets. They call a pocket of people were fighting us. And then they would run out of ammunition and run away from us. But it was endless. There were, Germany is a big country with a huge army. So they, even to the end, they had a lot of men fighting. But we knew we were winning, but we were yet to come upon the concentration camps. I'm out of sequence now. I don't know whether we met the Russians at that time on the Elbe River, or this was before the Elbe River. It was a mishmash. I don't remember. But we ran into this. I drew a picture of it. We ran into a little, a satellite camp of Buchenwald. They had several satellite work camps, not with Jews working. I don't know whether they were working on some machinery for the tanks or what. I don't know what they were doing there. But these were Dutch. I saw dead people. I saw French flags, Dutch, even some Italians. Believe it or not, their own allies were prisoners. And we found a lot of dead people. People were put in one building, which was unforgettable in my mind, and set afire. And one poor devil tried to claw his way out from under the burning building. And there was a picture flashed around the world of this man. He's actually, I have to show it to the camera. He's under the ground. Front torso, his head and his shoulders are out, but he was burnt to a crisp. He was still smoldering.
You saw that
scene. I saw that actual scene, and I said to myself, cruel, dirty bastards. That's the only word I could use to do a thing like, the war was almost over and these people were helpless. What was the purpose of the cruelty of doing such a horrible thing? And a few that did get out tried to climb the barbed wire fence and they were killed. They were machine gunned.
Well,
but that was before Buchenwald.
But yeah. Describe when you approached this camp.
The camp was.
What did you see and how did you get aware of what it was?
We knew right away. Somebody said there was a sign, took a photograph, there was a sign on the front. There was like a railroad going into the front, that's where we went, and a road with trucks that used to go in there, in the front gate. It said, Arbeit macht frei, work makes free, the famous sign that they had there. And that was Buchenwald. And we went in, and officers and alike, I don't care if they were Jewish, whoever, they were stunned what they saw. But people piled up like cordwood, dead bodies, ditches filled with bodies, people, human beings, like skeletons. The odor was terrible. As a matter of fact, I didn't see him, but Eisenhower was there that day. It was late in April, probably April 28th or 25th. Eisenhower went in and he said he had tears. And he said he wants the German people to talk about German people. They should, all the neighboring towns should march through this camp and not say that this never happened. They were to witness these bodies, and in many instances they were told to cart them away for a decent burial.
Did you see Germans were being stupefied. Did you see Germans being brought into the
camp? I saw them brought in and they were in tears, denying that they even knew. They were crying, they were shocked. They said, we never knew. So we would argue with them, how could you not know? Are you stupid? Are you ignorant? Don't you see? So I got word from a couple of them that I spoke with that they were throwing bread. This was when it was almost too late. They threw bread at them. Sometimes they would try to take them out and transport. They threw bread over the wall of these trucks and the bread would land amongst them. They would try, they felt so sorry for them. So I felt that there were some Germans that were sorry, genuinely sorry, but others kept quiet when they shouldn't have. They did not say a word. And they let this horrible thing happen. But I saw hundreds of bodies. Terrible.
Were you told what to do when you arrived at the camp?
We were told to...
What was your task?
That we couldn't help them. We had medicine. We had all kinds of first aid equipment. We had lots of food. I think I told you over the telephone. We were told not to feed them a regular meal, just soup, hot soup, which was good stuff. We had, you know, bean soup or whatever. Because it took, some of them hadn't eaten in weeks, and that was one of the bad things that I recall.
Those people that were still alive. Was that men, women, children?
I remember.
What do you remember?
I don't remember many women. I remember men. One man was a Greek. He wasn't Jewish. He came to help us at the kitchen truck, and he volunteered to do the pots and pans. And I gave him an extra pair of shoes that I had, having bad feet. I was one of the few with an extra pair of shoes. He never forgot me for that. Is it almost over? Anyway, his name was Steve. He was a captain who would smuggle Jews across the Aegean Sea in his fishing boat. He was really a heroic man. He told me he went hundreds of times with that little boat, smuggled a few people at a time. Finally, they Nazi patrol boat caught him and sent him to the concentration camp. The other two people I did meet was a very young, pretty girl, as I told you over the phone, about 15, very unusually pretty, and with her mother. We found them packing, I don't know how to describe it, but the contents of shells. You put this bag of gunpowder into the shell, and the German army used that. And they were lifting these heavy bags of gunpowder up to a shelf, and they were physically exhausted. We found them, and he said, put it down, you don't have to. We came to this camp, a work camp.
They were still working.
They were still working. I said, put it down, you're free.
We have to stop here. June 6, 1999, tape 3. I'm talking with Leon Adler. You were talking about this mother and daughter.
Yes.
Do you recall their names by any chance?
No, the girl was Ellen. I lost total touch with them. They came to America. They lived not far from the east side. They lived on the east side. I remember bringing them a radio. They were thrilled with a radio. They were very poor. The story, when we met the girl, she spoke good English. Mother didn't speak any English. She was about 40-ish. The girl was 15. And she said they were actually both stripped naked. They were in the crematorium, in that horrible room. It's a cinder block room. I remember seeing it with a little window, little steel door with a little window about 6 inches square. And the German guards stood outside of that window looking in. And these people were packed in like sardines. And they, by that time, they knew where their fate was. They were screaming. So the young girl said to the German, the guard at the door, at the window, she knocked on the window, and she says, "God will punish you, because you see what you're going to see, what you're going to get. You're going to suffer." So he says, "Oh, is that right?" So he says, "You know what? Death is too good for you." So he opened the door and he pulled her out by the arm. So she says, "Are you taking me out?" He says, "Yes, I'm going to work you to death. Dying this way is too good." So she says, "Well, take my mother out. That's my mother." She was also by the door. So he took them both out. And when we found them, they were doing this horrible work. They had been doing that for a couple of weeks.
Do you know where they had come from?
I don't remember at all.
What kind of nationality they had?
Something tells me that they were Germans, from Germany, one of the few survivors. I think they hid themselves, or somebody helped them, until they finally turned them in. Because very few German Jews were left by that time. The only ones left were a few Czechoslovakians. Hungarians were the last group taken. In 45, they could have been saved, if not for the weakness of, I'm ashamed to say, America was weak and didn't try harder to save them.
In the this ammunition factory where you met
Ellen
and her mother, how big a camp was that?
I just remember it was just a big factory with a few German guards. Not even barbed wire around it.
So I there were still guards when you came
there? There were a few guards left, yeah.
What did they do
when
you came there?
They were extremely cowardly rats, what you would call a rat. And they were cowering. And we had hundreds of German prisoners, you know, with they had this light green uniform. Hundreds of prisoners, thousands, marching along the road. And I was walking there, and I remember the lieutenant was next to me, and I spotted about four or five black uniforms hiding behind the ordinary Wehrmacht, which was an ordinary German soldier, probably drafted just like I was, you know, an ordinary guy. But these four or five guys, they were SS men, black uniforms with a skull on on the collar. And I said, "Sir," I said to the officer, "grab them." He says, "Why?" I says, "Grab them, they're SS men, SS, murderers." He said, "Well, what do you want me to do?" Imagine that, an officer, an American officer. I says, "What do I want you to do? With all due respect to you, I want you to grab them. They're criminals, the murderers, they're hiding there. Have them taken back to G2. You know, I still feel angry about when I hear about the stupidity of him. So finally he loaded them onto a jeep, and they sent them back to a prison camp where they belonged.
Was that your immediate officer?
I don't
Do
remember.
You
it was an officer,
was?
And I couldn't keep quiet. Yeah. I knew who they were by that time. I'd heard of the SS. Yeah. And I just, in good conscience, keep quiet and let them get away with it. But hundreds must have gotten away. They went to South America. And a guy like Mengele, a mass murderer, a torturer, experiment on people, got away and lived a long, good life in South America. This hurts me. I'm jumping the gun. The next big thing was Before we met the Russian army, that was an event of its own. I don't have to go into that. That was a great event. But before that, I wanted to talk about something else. I forgot what it was. What happened there? Oh, well, everything was really confused at that point. Maybe you could help.
Well, let's go back maybe to the camps when you came in. What was your task other than, for example, the kitchen duty? What did you
just army of occupation, just standing around. I understand that the day or 2 days before we came in, people like Elie Wiesel were liberated. People like him. There's a picture of him in the camp.
But you were in the medical unit.
Yeah, there wasn't much we could do to help them. We were told that we would only, if we tried to help the few survivors, they were walking around, wandering around. If we tried to help them, there wasn't much we could do.
Did you talk with some of them?
Yeah, some. Well, I don't recall exact words. But they one man was there for quite a while, and he told me that believe it or not, there were Germans in there. He says some of the German people who sympathized with the Jews were thrown in there. I spoke to one man. He said he was slated to be killed, and this was the beginning of May by that time. He was slated to be killed in June. So I said, why? You're a German. He says, I have a bad leg. He walked with a crutch. He says, anybody that wasn't normal, so-called normal, a gypsy, a homosexual, they didn't like his face, he was deformed in some way, had to be killed. That was their awful philosophy. And
did you get into any of the barracks?
No, we just went through it. We saw the barracks with wooden benches, wooden slats, about 3-4 high. That's where the people were kept. They were given very little food. Oh, there was one incident of they were in Buchenwald. There were blocks, what they call a block of buildings. One block. The people were well fed. This, if you could find it in history, the commander of that block just disobeyed orders. He kept the people going. He fed them barely enough, but he didn't perform any cruelties or kill people or let them starve. So in other words, had more of them disobeyed orders, more people would have survived. If he was a German, a Nazi, and he says, I don't want to do that, they seldom punished him. So there was one block was actually, the people were okay. It's amazing.
While you were there, did people start to bury the dead? Who did
they,
it?
They
How
did.
Was it done?
They made the Germans do it, the little that I saw. They were put in graves, and they had to do it. Mm-hmm. They wore handkerchiefs over their faces. It was horrible. But as I said before, many were crying and denying that they didn't realize what they were doing.
Did you come across any children kept in the camps?
I don't remember seeing any children. Maybe not where I was. Mostly men, I would say, with these striped uniforms. And
did you tell them that you were Jewish?
Oh yeah, any opportunity I did. Yeah. Did I tell you about? I told you about Hermann Göring.
Yeah.
I didn't say it on the camera then.
Well, you were not there when it happened.
No, I wasn't there when it happened. But he tells me it's a true story.
Yeah. You had one story that you wanted to share with something that you found in.
Well, the greatest thing I think I ever did in my life was at the time when I was there about 1 or 2 days after Buchenwald was actually liberated. So I talked with different people. So these people spoke good English. There were 4 Czechoslovakian men who had been liberated. And they were in poor shape, but they had been put in a camp probably most recently. So they were very thin and starving, but one died later. But 3 of the men told me exactly where they said the Germans buried 2 books. And it was precisely at the great big entrance where it says Arbeit macht frei. You walk in, you go into the camp, there's railroad tracks and everything, and there's ruts. It had rained a lot. There were what they call a rut, R-U-T, with water filling the ruts from the trucks. The trucks' tires made this rut. And I said, you mean to tell me that they went underneath that rut, deep underneath, and in the mud they buried? He says, yeah, because nobody would ever think of looking there. And he showed me the exact spot. He had counted out the poles. Barbed wire is attached to a pole, like a wooden pole. He counted out, and he said, I don't remember which one, say number 5. Number 5 pole, and that, you walk in, go into the road, and that's where you dig. So Abe Kovler, soldier like me, from Webster, Massachusetts, my buddy, whom I lost touch with, and I, we took our little army folding shovels. They're little shovels, like this big. The head of the shovel is this big. Folding shovel, a green shovel, I remember. And every soldier had that to dig a foxhole. So we used those shovels late at night. We were afraid we'd get arrested or something. So we got into the camp, and we dug for about 3-4 hours with a little flashlight. It was very difficult. We sweated like anything. It was a warm day, warm night. And finally, I hit pay dirt. I hit something with my shovel. I said, Abe, I think we hit pay dirt. He says, let's get it. So we dug around the books. It was very heavy. Each book weighed about, I'd say, 15, 20 pounds.
How big a book?
A book, if you ever saw a large birthday cake, comes in a carton from the bakery. You ever see a big carton? That size, a big size book, about 12 inches wide, about 6 or 8 inches thick. We got them out, and I paged through each book.
Were they wrapped?
They were wet. The covers were muddy. But inside, miraculously, was perfectly dry. The water was thick mud, hadn't seeped in yet. So they were buried about a week before the Allies came to liberate the camp. So needless to say, we got them out. I paged through, and I have to say for the record, hundreds of, or maybe thousands of names in each book with tiny lines, tiny print, written by German handwriting. The names of the people, and I took it, the number of the tattoo, and the date was unmistakable. The date, like, would say, they reverse it a little bit. They say 6 January 45. So I knew that's the date the poor person was killed. So if you multiply all those pages from these big ledgers by like 100 on a page, these a lot of people. And I remember the tiny, carefully written handwriting. They took careful records. And so I said to Abe, what do we do now? We've got these 2 big, heavy books What do we do now? We get caught with this, we'll get court-martialed. We're not supposed to be here. Mind you, it was about 2 o'clock in the morning. Abe had connections. He was a wise guy, kid, very smart young fellow. And he found somebody that would loan him a Jeep the next morning, which was only a few hours off. It was about 3 in the morning. And he drove the Jeep with the books about 20 miles. We kept asking, where's G2? Where's G2? You know, everything's confusion at that time. Sometimes the medics were in front of the infantry. You know, it's crazy confusion. And so finally somebody said, that's the tent for G2, intelligence. So we went in there and we said to the officer, we're from the medics. We found these two books in Buchenwald. We want to turn them in. So he looked them over. He was stunned. He said, wow. He says, this is some evidence. He said, where did you get it? And we told him where we got it. We dug them out. So he says, well, thanks a lot. This is going to go. His last words were, this will be well taken care of. Thank you guys very much. We didn't get a receipt, nothing. I remember they were like a grayish-green cloth-bound books, about this size and this thick. And we lost touch of that. And all of a sudden, watching television about 1992, mind you, just a few years ago, I saw a 10-second clip. These books were on display from World War II, books of people's names. Those were the two books. And I don't think there are any other camps that had those. Somebody took records, careful records, in Buchenwald. And as far as I know, nowhere else. So why did they keep those books in heaven's name? Why didn't they turn them into the Nuremberg trials? Prime evidence. I think it's called prima facie evidence. Unmistakable. They're guilty with thousands of names. Why were they hidden? I'd like to know. And where are they today? I'd like to ask publicly, if anybody could help Mr. Spielberg or anybody, find out under the Freedom of Information Act, Freedom of Information Act, you have a right to see any books or any papers, any secret papers, whatever it is, you have a right to look at it and study it, and maybe even show it in a museum. That's what I want.
Do you recall what kind of TV?
It was a news flash on the news, and I called my wife in, and 10 seconds it was over. They didn't say who had it. It was held by the government. That's all I know. It could be in the National Archives. It could be held by FBI, CIA, Pentagon, Army Archives. I really don't know. But everything is held, written down. My name, my address, my experience is in there with millions of other people. I think it's in St. Louis. They have archives with every soldier that ever served, Navy, Army, Marines, whatever. They keep careful records, but why are they hiding it? Who are they protecting?
Do you have the name of the officer you gave the book to?
No, we're just two kids. We're about early 20s. We're just young, innocent kids. Very innocent, very, you know, we didn't know. But we knew the meaning of what we had in our hands. But who were they protecting? Some Nazis that came to America? I'm ashamed to tell you, but I love this country, but we have people that sympathize with the Nazis here. Mm-hmm. And who are they? Are they protecting these people all these years? Why were they hiding it from the Nuremberg trial? I'm sure, what was his name? Jackson, the head prosecutor, would have loved to have gotten his hands on those books. So that's, I think, one of the most important things ever did by accident, pure accident. It happened to be me and my buddy, Mr. Kovler. Kovler might be dead by now.
Can you spell his last name, please?
Yeah, K-O-V-L-E-R, from Webster, Massachusetts. I understand his father had a big store there, some kind of a big department store. He was a rich kid, what I call a rich kid.
Did you stay in touch with him after that?
I stayed in touch with him a couple of years, and then he stopped answering the letters. And we used to have a lot of fun together.
Yeah. After this really interesting event with the books, how much longer did you stay around?
I stayed in the Army of Occupation for quite a few more months, like another half a year. And then they felt that...
How long did you stay in Buchenwald?
I really don't know. Couldn't have been more than a week or two. But one day is enough. I'm laughing ironically. One day is enough to visit and see these horrible things.
And where else did you go after that?
Well, after that I went to... they made me guarding prisoners, believe it or not.
Where was
a guy
that?
Like me that hates guns. I don't know. In Germany, I was put on, like, occupation duty. I guarded, like, 50 prisoners on a truck. They went to work that day, and I had a little pea shooter gun, and I stood in the back, which was ridiculous. So one of the incident that happened there was one of the German prisoners of war, in perfect English, he says, "What would you do if we threw you off the truck and killed you and escaped?" So I was smart enough to say, "Look, the war is over. I don't want to hurt anybody, but you see this gun has 6 bullets. You'll hear 6 shots in the air. I'm going to shoot 6 times, empty out my gun. And then you could do whatever you want. I don't care. I really don't care anymore." So he says, "You know, you're really a good guy." I says, "Well, the war's over. I don't want to kill you. Because it's nonsense. What's to be gained?" So he says, "You know what? We're going to leave you alone. Because I tested you out. You're a nice guy." So that was an incident that happened. But ridiculous things happen.
Did you feel angry against these people?
I felt rage. I used to get, I'm the type of guy, I have a take after my father, I get red. I was enraged, especially when I saw what they did to those people in that burning shack, is setting it on fire. The cruelty of them. I remember, first I was shocked. Then I remember walking around, I was kicking things. I was frustrated. I couldn't do anything about it.
How long after they burnt it did you get there?
This must have been the next day. Because we were told by some other soldiers, you want to see something, go on this road, you'll see something. We had missed it. There's different roads, you know. So we took this certain road and we came upon this. It was a horrible thing.
Was the fire out totally?
The fire was still smoldering. The man who we're talking about that tried to escape underneath the building, still smoldering, the smell of flesh and gasoline, burnt flesh like you roast a chicken. You know, the kosher butcher takes the feathers off with a flame. You've probably seen that. That smell, unforgettable smell. It's a burning, like burning feathers, or burning flesh.
Did anything else burn, or was it just this?
It was the house, and they were all, ironically, they were not Jews. These were people from slave labor from different camps, from different countries, rather. They were working on the outskirts of Buchenwald, inside Buchenwald were mostly Jews. There were probably some gypsies there. But these are the only other nationalities I remember seeing. There were 20, 30 people lying about whom they had machine gunned. And then to deliberately burn these people, it's the cruelty of it, unnecessary cruelty. They were losing the war. Why didn't they just leave these people alone and run away? What was it? Terrible. How can you forgive that? Unnecessary cruelty, that's the two words.
Where were you when the war actually was over?
Well, we were occupying some German's home. Remember sitting there and...
Where was that approximately? Do you have any idea?
It was in... we were in the outskirts of Leipzig, a pretty big city, Halle, H-A-L-L-E. And we were billeted in that home. Remember having breakfast and looking out the window. Nice home, untouched by the war. And looking out the window, we see an airplane flying. It was some Germans, last-minute Germans, trying to get away. So the little airplane, and they hit the wires, the electric wires, and came down. They got killed. So that was one incident there. So then, after spending an uneventful time, the war was over, just guarding prisoners and doing other duties.
You had no medical duties?
No. They said, being that I had won the Bronze Star, I had other decorations.
What did you get the Bronze Star for?
The Bronze Star was in the Rhineland, you know, around the Rhine River. The Germans were running away, and they turned their anti-aircraft guns on us, what they called an 88 cannon. 88 millimeters round. They aimed it, instead of at airplanes, they aimed it straight at us. We had some casualties. Infantry people died. And I was trying to save a couple of guys that were wounded, you know, in the shoulders. Not deathly wounds, but we were trying to save them. All of a sudden, I came upon a burning tank.
So we have to stop here, and we'll continue on the next tape.
Okay. Well, listen.
This is tape 4 in the interview with Mr. Leon Adler on June 6, 1999. And we continue, you were telling me about the tank.
Yeah, well, I'm going out of order, I'm retrogressing. This happened in March of 1945. We were still in the Rhineland. I think we had just crossed the Rhine River below Remagen Bridgehead, and one of the tanks was smoldering, was on fire, heavy, thick smoke. And most of the men in the tank were killed. They were hit directly by an 88 anti-aircraft gun, which aimed straight at them. And I understand once it's the shell of the tank is inside the tank. It bounces all around. It's very hard for the poor people inside to escape. So two of them were still alive, and my litter squad and I came upon it, and we were trained in a certain situation to tie a strap around the person, the wounded guy's shoulders, under his armpits. So that's what I did. I climbed up there, and a couple of guys said, "You're crazy. The tank is on fire. You know, it could go up." So I said, "Those guys are screaming." So we found two men still alive. One we got out easily. He was hurt in his shoulder and the heel. We put him down on the ground near the tank. The other one was a heavy man, happened to be a Jewish man, an officer. I think he was a lieutenant from Philadelphia. He had horrible wounds to his chest. He was torn open. And the minute we looked at him, I got him out. He was a heavy man. So the other fellows, we both pulled on our belts. We tied each had a belt under our pants belt under his armpits. We were trained for that. And we pulled him out, and he was in terrible agony. We lied him down. He was conscious through this whole thing. And the touching thing is the man said, "I'm so sorry that I'm so heavy." You know? So I said, "Where are you from?" He says, "Philadelphia." I says, "You're sorry?" I says, if we could save you, what do you mean you're sorry? Never be sorry. I hope we could save you. But when the corporal that was with us, the head of our little litter squad, stretcher squad, said, he went like this to me, "This guy isn't, we have to carry him about a mile back, mile and a half back to the tent where they operate on him, the field, little field hospital. It's more like a big tent with red crosses on it." So he says, "He'll never make it." So what do we do? One guy we got called the ambulance. An ambulance picked him up. He was barely wounded, but savable. We knew he's going to live. But this guy, what do we do? We decided right then and there, he's in agony. So we gave him an extra shot of morphine. Morphine came in like a little toothpaste tube with a needle and a glass cap. So you get rid of cap and you squeeze the morphine. So it was a terrible thing we did, but we put him to sleep permanently. So my conscience hurt for about 2 weeks after that, you know. I felt very bad about it. We played God, but there was no other choice. What do you do? Let the man suffer such an agonizing, fully conscious, or you put him out of his misery? So I, unfortunately, in the middle of the war, I never found out who he was, but just that he came from Philadelphia, first lieutenant, I believe. And then an officer saw what we had done, you know, the four of us. And I think all four of us got a Bronze Star for that. So it's a good experience and a bad one.
Yeah.
You kind of say it. You know. But
You wanted to tell about the surgeon that impressed you so much.
During all this last 5 months of the war, that's all we did. We had so many adventures, so many people. We must have saved countless people. You know, they would have died, bleeding to death. And, you know, I don't even want to go in. This man was in back this field hospital. He was a part of our company of 110
men. What was his name? Do you remember?
I don't remember, but he was from Montana. The only man I ever met in the Army from Montana. He was what you would describe as a little Casper milk toast. A little man. And he spoke the only way is very effeminate. Oh, my. Oh, dear. You know? And the nicest, gentlest little man, he stood under the worst fire, artillery, machine guns, strafing, calmly. You know, you operate on someone like this. It's a suture. You put, it's a round hook, I don't know if you know it, a needle, a round needle, and you sew them up. He's standing there very calmly. And people are screaming, running, hey, an airplane's coming, look out, get in, get underneath. You know, you had holes to jump in. He didn't go. He stood there doing his job. So what do you give a guy like that? What kind of medal do you give him? Congressional Medal of Honor? What I want to say is, the least person you would dream about doing such heroic work, it was that man. Yeah.
How did you cope with all the misery that you saw and all the wounds?
I thought of it only because I was so young. I was single, had no wife at home. I was just my innocence. A kid, a baby, you know?
But you must have come across really horrible injuries and pain, you
wash it out of your mind, most of it. I still remember, naturally, because I wouldn't say it, but I still remember the injuries, but I try to dwell on other things. You could go crazy.
Did it come back to you?
Yeah, I remember some of the injured people.
Do you still dream about it?
No, I did when I first got home. I was very jumpy and nervous. I was able to go to a place called Mount McGregor, upstate New York. It happened to be where Ulysses Grant died, in a little cottage there. But they have a camp for people that had terrible war experiences. So I went there for about 7 weeks, and it's a relaxing country scene, you know, very quiet and very nice. Somebody, when I first got out of the army, somebody tapped me on the shoulder, I jumped a foot, because I reacted later. I didn't react at that point. I did crazy things I would never do today, like going into the burning tank. I'd never do that. Not have a wife and children, you know, I would never. But I was a crazy kid. I didn't realize the circumstances, the consequences of it. Mm-hmm. So you do, you do things on the moment that you. We were so, esprit de corps. We were so closely knit. We were a great bunch of guys.
Did you make friends?
Rugged. I made some friends. A couple of years ago, we met what's the name of that? Down in Virginia. What's the name of that place in Virginia? We had a meeting there, met some of the old buddies. Some still alive. There's about 10 of us still alive out of 110. Many were older than I was. Probably if they were alive, they wouldn't be in their 80s, 85. I'm 75, and I'm just a kid compared to some of them. But it was a great experience, but you ask a good question. I wondered myself. I think I just turned to the immediate needs. We wanted to save that guy that was lying out there screaming. We had a willpower. And I'm telling you, we crossed some terrible rocks and mountains and things. Imagine carrying a man and your arms get tired, so you switch around to the left arm to carry. And the human body, the top is heavier, much heavier than the lower part. So you'd switch. But a lot of things go on that people don't realize what happened.
When the war was over in May, and how much longer did you stay in Europe?
Say till the thing that happened was, I would guess till from say May of 1945 till about January of 46. And by that time, they told me that I could, if I could make it to Antwerp, I could be put on a boat and discharged and come back to the States. So I was on my way, sometime in January, I don't know my exact date, but history will tell you. We were going down the Autobahn past the Stuttgart, big town, on the way towards Antwerp. We came across General Patton's car. That was just a few minutes after he was hit by a truck. So we said, what happened here? We see the flag with the stars, General, it had to be Patton. So somebody said he was hit by a truck and he had his neck broken. He's still alive. So we said, well, where is he? They said, well, he's on his way to the hospital. So by amazing coincidence, we ran into that. So, and then we went to Antwerp and waited a few more weeks. Finally, on a boat.
While you were in Europe, how did you have a chance to keep in touch with your family? Did they know where you were?
Well, you were not allowed to say where you were. You always had to say somewhere in Germany. And one time I wrote, really happened. I'm an animal lover. So I wrote, I'm sorry, the cat died. So the captain called me in. They censored your mail. It was a very funny thing that happened. He says, what are you talking about, Adler? Cat died. You're telling them where you are in Germany, aren't you? So somebody else said, no, Captain, this is Adler. I know he loves animals. It's true what he said. And so the captain said, what a crazy thing to write in a letter. Get out of here. He chased me out. He said, well, you know, it's such a, like saying, I'm sorry, Grandma Martha died, or some, like a code word. So that was a funny incident.
And you received letters from home?
I think I said my father wrote almost every day. And one time I was so tired. By the way, we used to work sometimes 3 days in a row. There were so many people injured and hurt. We didn't even count the hours without sleep. So I finally fell asleep and they were shaking me for a half hour. There's letters for you. We have a bunch of letters for you. Finally, I woke up. I remember sleeping on some hay or something. And there they were, about 26 letters from my dad. And each letter said, at the end, love, Mom, Pop, and Ruth. Ruth was my sister. And they laughed hysterically, those letters, when I read them. Because he wrote in broken English. But you knew what he wrote. He wrote English, but misspelling, didn't I told you? You could appreciate that. The English language is very difficult. Didn't I tell you? Didn't I told you? And the other soldiers, they were rolling in the aisles laughing at the letters. I didn't mean to make fun of them, but we had to have some fun. So it's an interesting thing. Okay. But then I came home, I was discharged at Fort Dix. And on the way back, we were on a Liberty boat. We spent 21 days at sea. We hit one of the biggest storms in history in March of 1946. And the huge waves. Everybody was sick except a few of us, like me. I didn't get seasick, but I'm telling you, almost everybody on board ship was, it's a Liberty ship, it's shaped like a bathtub. So sometimes the waves were so big and the storm was so big, it tossed the ship back. Instead of making progress towards New York, it was actually flung back a couple of hundred miles. Well, after 21 days, we finally landed. It was a great day, we finally got home. So after about approximately 3 years, I was finally discharged.
And how did you get your life back?
Well,
What did you do?
I was, when I first got out, it all, like you were asking me, it all hit me. And I was very jumpy, very nervous. I shouted at my folks, didn't get along with them. The war makes you this way. My mother has certain ways, and I says, I don't want to do this, and I don't want to eat what you cook, things like that. You know, you get the, some people are affected that way. I was in my early 20s. But what do I want to say? So then I knew office work. I'm an expert typist, by the way. I knew all that. And rather than go back to do office work, I went to work in a factory. I didn't think I would be able to do office work again because I was fatigued mentally, you know. But then after so many years of floundering around, I went back into office work. I became a paralegal for a big law firm. It ended happily, but first few years of my life, I was floundering around. I'm married to my wife, Lee, for going to be 49 years. It's a long time. But she went through thick and thin with me. The last half of our marriage, it was good. I made good money, good living. The first years, I should have just gone back right in there again, right into office work. And I wasted time going into factory work, and I tried office management. I floundered around. I wasted a lot of time. So it's... Now that I'm 75 years old, I just want to say for the record, the one thing on my mind is to get the, I don't want any personal publicity. I want these books brought out where they belong, in the daylight. And as I say, if Mr. Spielberg and his organization could do anything at all, I beg him to do it. I want to leave you with that. That's my message. Bring it out where it belongs, even though it's kind of late for so many people who died and suffered. That's about it.
I would like to also, just as a very last positive thing also, you have children and grandchildren.
Yes, I have my two daughters, especially the older daughters, very nicely married.
What's her name?
Susan. Susan's married about 14 years now, I think. And we have a lovely 9-year-old granddaughter, very sweet girl, very bright.
Her name is?
Her name is Pauline, named after a grandparent on my son-in-law's side. And little Joseph, named after my father. He's 4 years old. He's a tough little guy, very extremely bright, very difficult to deal with, very independent. I won't do that, you know. He's a good kid, but he's a handful. 4 years is a tough age too. But I'm very proud of them. And unfortunately, my other daughter is ill. So
what's her name?
That's Elaine. She's ill, and unfortunately, there's nothing much we can do, but we try to live with that.
Yeah. Well, I think now we'll call your wife. And
you want to say something?
We stop for a moment, and right. Then we'll call your wife, and thank you.
Oh, my pleasure. Well, this is my wife of, it's going to be 49 years, this December 23rd. We married just before Christmas. Lillian Adler, we call her Lee for short, and this is my darling wife for so many years.
I'm just happy for Leon. they know how long he wanted this to be discovered. I just hope they can find the books. Because I pointed out, he's most anxious to find them. That's about all I have to say.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for having
us. It's our pleasure.
Thank you.
These are my parents, Dora Handworker, Adler, of course, and Joseph Adler. Picture was probably taken in the late 1920s, I would guess, in Coney Island, in Brooklyn, New York. My father was a good-looking, the girls used to. This is a picture of my immediate family. In the back is my father, Joseph, my mother, Dora, and I had a half-sister, Ruth, who was on the right. She's 9 years older than I am, still alive. This on the left with the suit is my brother, Irving, lives in New Jersey. And that's me, the little guy is me in the center front. This is a picture of me taken in summer of 1943 in Camp Shelby, Hattiesburg, Mississippi, on an extremely hot day. As you can see, I'm perspiring heavily, and I was already a member of the 69th Infantry Division at the time. This is a picture taken, as it says there, in March of 1944, in Camp Shelby, Mississippi. This is Company A of the 369th Medical Battalion, 69th Division. As you can see, we're a lean and mean group. And that's me with the arrow in the back, top back. This is a medal, actual medal of the Bronze Star. There are higher medals than that. There's a Silver Star and so on. But I'm quite proud of this. It was given to me for saving a couple of people out of a burning tank. This happy little girl is, when she was a little girl, is my younger daughter, Elaine. Elaine Mindy Adler is her real full name. She was probably about 2 and a half, I would guess. It's hard to say. That's a picture of my wife and I, Lee Adler and Leon Adler. I think this was probably taken in Florida in the 1980s. This is a picture of my older daughter, Susan. Her full name is Susan Bonney. Her husband of about 14 years is Ira. His last name is Walter, Ira Walter. And this is a picture taken at some fair we went to in probably in the late 80s. Went to some wedding, and that's a picture of them. This is my pride and joy, my sweet little granddaughter. She's going to be 10 soon, Pauline. And Joseph is her little brother. He's 4 and a half. And this is a picture taken in probably in when they were living in Jacksonville, Florida.
What's your grandson's name?
Joseph.
Okay.